Welcome to the strange and wonderful world of Barbara Ragazzi, an AI fashion designer who will be presenting her work in a moment. Hello, Malcolm. This is the second in our series, Digital Futures, an introduction to AI for designers. And it's the first of our tutorials. We have five tutorials, and with each tutorial, we are going to showcase the work of an inspirational designer from different fields as a way of kind of inspiring you. And then we're going to go on to the tutorials themselves and to explain how you might go about this. This is a series that's offered by Digital Futures for free. Our concern in Digital Futures is to break down not just the walls of the classroom, but also the social and economic barriers, and to bring these ideas to everyone around the globe. Today's session is one of a series. We have four more tutorials before a Pecha Kucha towards the end and a roundtable discussion. And today I'm delighted to have a range of really inspirational individuals to present their work. I'm just here going to give you their Instagram handles, their Instagram addresses, because all of the work these days is uploaded to Instagram. And this is the place where you can keep track of the astonishing work that's going to happen. This is not just to this day, today's session, but to all our sessions. So I'm also giving you at the bottom here the Digital Futures and also my own Instagram account, so you could follow what we're promoting. I'd also encourage you to sign up for Digital Futures International and to register on our YouTube channel for the videos that we offer. Everything that we do is uploaded to our YouTube channel to be available for free for everyone around the globe. So please sign up for that and also consult our Digital Futures channel. So today we're going to kick off with Barbara Ragazzi, one of the most astonishing, I think, designers that you can find using Midjourney right now, with a real ravish imagination and really showing us just how this world can explode with these beautiful colors and these new ideas. Barbara is herself a fashion designer. She has over 20 years experience working with some of the leading fashion labels. She's also been a director of an art director of various fashion magazines. And with AI, with Midjourney, she's suddenly been invigorated with a new passion. Barbara will be the first to present. I just want to quickly mention our other presenters. Joshua Vermillion, who is no stranger to this. He's been on our Digital Futures before. Joshua is an associate professor at the Las Vegas University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and the School of Architecture. He's someone who has a long reputation for publishing books and articles and doing workshops on the various technologies. And he's been showing himself to be one of the leaders in the world in the field of Midjourney, and he will be talking about how we can connect it with WeChat. It's a great delight and honor to have Joshua here today to share his passion for Midjourney. And then we move on to Sarah Faron, who's been from Syria, who is currently in Istanbul, who is part of the Digital Futures team, has been working tirelessly, not only on some of the efforts to do with the earthquake in her home country, but also in supporting and promoting Digital Futures, and indeed on the graphics for this particular session. She'll be looking at stable diffusion and how you can use Dream Studio and Colab. I should say that Sarah herself has studied also in Eli Sava School in Barcelona. So I want to start then by inviting Barbara to show some of her inspirational work. And to share her screen, and then we'll move on to Joshua, followed by Sarah. And at the end, we'll have questions. If anyone has any questions who was following on YouTube or Bilibili, please send them in the chat and we can answer them. Okay, Barbara, welcome.
Buongiorno. Okay, thank you very much. Buongiorno. Hi, everybody. Ciao a tutti. So, I am Barbara, and I come from Italy, as
you have. Could you share your screen, Barbara?
Yes, of course.
Thank you.
My screen, and I am ready to show you everything.
It's still sharing.
Yes, wait only a minute that I have to, oh my God. Of course, there is always one problem when you don't want to have problems. Okay. Wait a minute only.
Okay.
I have to do this first. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, everybody. It's my first time in one thing like that. So I am a bit stupid for all this. And okay, now it's ready. Yeah. Okay. So I am Barbara. Come from Italy. I'm a fashion designer from 20 years, specialized in knitwear. Sorry for my English, please. It's not my first language, but I hope you can understand all. I started AI in end of August 22, and first months were for learning and discovery of Midjourney. Then I started to use it, thinking to work with AI. So I begin with this. This is the first series I made with a 3D designer. I made the pattern. He made the motion. And this was the first meeting between AI and fashion. Then this is the second, is a knitwear series with Norwegian team. First time I had the wow effect and also a real knit effect, because first was only crochet. Then the second is Scotland tartan, where I experimented the laying flat clothes without models, and was very interesting also, because it was very hard to do. The third is botanical twins, futuristic knitwear with botanical inspiration. This was very amazing and funny to make. This is my first series with like a complete collection. It's a blue series with also makeup and accessories. And this series was very interesting for makeup artists also. This is the sixth series, the sport bride, where I mixed different sports with the bride dress and neon colors and neon lights. So you can see tennis inspiration. This is also tennis. This is ice skating. This is the seventh series and is neon fluo knit series, where I mixed sculpture knit with fluo led accents, a futuristic inspiration, but also with knit. This is a different series, is on demand, as you can see in the at the side. I asked to followers which clothes they want to see made from me. Very funny and social experiment, giving me the opportunity to explore the theme, not properly in trend, but also very interesting. Oh, this series was very, very nice to make and appreciated is the flower covers, where the focus is on magazine covers with flower looks. You see Nog instead of Vogue. This is Midjourney that is very fantasy. This is the last one, the pastel camouflage. This is more actually collection and more fashion, not high couture, but is a fashion. As you can see, I make very large Syria, but always I change point of view, remaining in the fashion concept. And perhaps you can see also the difference between first images then last, because Midjourney changes so fast, and also the images are better and better. Every image is edited in Photoshop because of many fingers, other body problems to solve, obviously clothes problems, colors to adjust. No one of my images is posted without editing. And this is it. This is my work. I love Midjourney and I love AI. I am also experimenting other AI, but the magic and the surprising for me is always Midjourney. And I think for fashion, we need this. We need new inspiring, new surprise, and new magic, because we are a little boring of this, of everything we have. So perhaps for me, this is the future, and I believe in this a lot. So I have finished. This is it.
Grazie, Barbara, grazie. Bellissima, bellissima. Your work is so exquisite, and I absolutely, I absolutely love the colors. In architecture, you see I'm wearing black. We all wear black, and we really are in denial in some way. But to see that was such like a, it's like the Italian language itself. It's such so beautiful and colorful and wonderful. We look forward to tracking your work, because clearly there's something you're passionate about. And thank you so much for sharing your passion today.
Thanks very, to you.
Very, very beautiful work. Grazie, grazie, grazie.
Thanks to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you. So let's start the tutorial proper. And I want to welcome Joshua, who's in Las Vegas right now, and to share his screen. Joshua, welcome, and thank you so much for also sharing your passion about Midjourney. Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Yeah. Perfect. Well, thank you, Neil.
Do you want to? Okay, that's full screen, is it? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Right?
Yes. Okay.
Great. So I have a quick outline in front of me, and I'll just quickly sort of let everybody know where we're going. I'm actually showing Discord right now, and this is the platform that we'll be using today. I'll also, we'll go to midjourney.com in our browsers, and I'll show you how you can create an account if you need to, how to link that account up to Discord. As well as where the Midjourney app and documentation and archives are. Then we'll dive right in and actually start to make some pictures from words. And we'll talk about basic prompting. We'll talk about some of the basic settings and even using imagery and other sort of things for the prompts. So we'll try to cover as much as we can today. And so this is Discord. It's an app and it's free. You can download it from the App Store if you want to use it on your phone. You can go to Discord and Google it and download it for your desktop or laptop as well if you need to. It's a free app. It's for messaging and with Teams. As you can see, I'm part of several different teams here. And when you just go to Midjourney, here we go. Here's Midjourney's Discord channel. Really, this is the interface that you use primarily when you're dealing with Midjourney. Instead of messaging your friends, you're messaging a chatbot. I'm just going to quickly switch over to my web browser, right? I'm on midjourney.com. And I'm logged in, and so you can see now that it's giving me a grid of all kinds of things that I've, you know, this is what I was doing last night, I guess, part of this morning. What you can see is I'm logged in, and I have an archive of all the stuff that I've generated in Midjourney. Let me just click on the archive button here. It's a little more helpful. little. But you can basically search and sort through your the results as you enter your prompts, and it generates imagery. You can download each one, or there's a download tool that you can sort of batch download, and which is kind of helpful from time to time. Hopefully you guys can hear me just fine. I don't know, my images are loading kind of slowly. That happens sometimes, but you can see here, you can go back in the timeline. Thanks, Neil. You can go back in the timeline and start to find things. There's lots of different ways to sort of attack this. If I'm not logged in, what happens is I go to a splash screen and it asks me to create an account. And what you can do is you basically create an account, and then it gives you a link and asks you if you want to link that account to your Discord. Once you've signed in and you link your account to Discord, I go to my Discord. I'm right back here. Right. So this is what you'll see. It'll show you the Midjourney server, and you'll see that there's lots of different rooms here. All right. So I'll just go to one of these rooms, and we'll see lots of other users generating things. You can see that they're entering prompts. Portrait oil painting, hyper-realist, Klimt made, and then Midjourney spits out the results, right? So it's really just sort of chatting back and forth with the diffusion model, okay? All right. Back in Safari, I just wanted to quickly talk about this. In midjourney.com, there's some other links that are really helpful. And I have this one bookmarked. It's called docs.midjourney.com, D-O-C-S for documentation. It's a lot of documentation, a lot of helpful tips and guides here, including the manual. So you can begin to, if you can't remember something or you need a little bit of troubleshooting to get on board, it's all right here. Okay? It's actually pretty helpful. If there's some settings you don't quite remember, you can always come here and sort of take a look. All right. And I don't know about you guys, but I just want to make, like, let's start typing in some words and start making some images. So what I've done is I've actually directly started chatting with the Midjourney bot here. So I have my own chat thread, and I can just sort of see my own stuff, right? This is one way of doing it. It's helpful because then you don't have everybody else's images popping up with your own, and I'm trying to sort of find what you did and what they did, et cetera, right? So it's kind of helpful. So what you'll see here, hopefully you can see, is that I just quickly did a few very simple prompts right before this session, just to sort of give you a flavor of what this looks like, and then we'll start to write our own, right? This one is a monumental undulating tall space made from concrete. And then it gives four options based off of that prompt. It's trying its best to draw what we command it to draw. I just changed the material, a monumental undulating tall space made from laminated plywood in this case, right? So, you know, it's really interesting. You know, I'm using specific terms that sort of I've just from trial and error have come across that sort of have a disproportionate influence on the results. So monumental, undulating, just trying to be a little expressive here, giving it some materials in order to sort of shape the results a little more. So moving from generic to sort of using some particular words to try to get certain results. Here you can see the difference in the prompt is that I actually changed the aspect ratio. So this is a 9:16 aspect ratio. So it's a tall portrait rather than a square aspect ratio. So just going through and double checking this instead of describing the geometry as undulating, let's say I change it to angular, right? But still keeping concrete, you can see that it starts to change the results. Right? Okay, so let's get typing. First thing, I'm going to message the bot. I always type in that slash, and it's the most magical command there is, imagine, right? You're telling the robot to imagine something, and then you type it out. So I'll just say a tall interior space t- tall interior space made from glowing glass surfaces. I'll give it some more description. I'll say volumetric lighting, which means I'll start to get some of those light rays and things like that in. And let's just see what happens. All right. You can see I just messaged the bot, and pretty soon you'll see some images pop up and they'll start to denoise, right? In other words, it's starting from static or Gaussian noise, and it slightly starts to sort of come further and further into focus. And we'll see that here. It'll give us a percentage of how quickly it's moving. And while that's working, you can see it iteratively starting to come into more and more focus. All right. So for better or worse, this is what I got, right? And again, I'm usually doing this with, you can try your best to try to get it to generate things that you are thinking in your head. But honestly, I find the most productive things are when it spits out things that you weren't thinking of that challenges your understandings or maybe subverts what you were, how you were thinking about your design prompt. So it's lovely how it handles color as well and light. And so again, I added volumetric lighting, I said glowing, sort of things like that. I could start to specify different colors, let's see. And again, this is what you can do. You can begin to either iterate your text prompt, or you can begin to iterate based off of the results. So let's just add one more thing to the text prompt before I start to show, we go down that rabbit hole of making variations from the images that it spits out at us. So I'm just gonna quickly enter this in. I'm gonna say interior space made from warm colored glowing glass surfaces. Now we can sort of give it a little more control. So we're gonna get some warm colors here. All right, so while that's going, what you'll notice is that it gives me four images every time I enter in my prompt. It's really handy because it's sort of interpreting these things in different ways with different seeds. And oh, there it's starting to pop up the new result here. But underneath, you can see that we can upscale any of these four. In other words, we can take that thumbnail, make it larger, and start to look at it more closely. Or we can generate variations off of each of these. So I'm just going to do that really quickly. And again, this is what's interesting here. I'm just going to say submit. Okay. I like this one. I like the colorations of this one. So this variations of the fourth one. 1, 2, 3, 4. Just go ahead and click that. I have my remix setting on, and we'll talk about the settings here in a bit. What that lets me do is that actually lets me change the prompt or adjust the prompt if I want to based off of this variation. I'm just going to go ahead and hit submit right now. Don't want to throw too much at you. There's lots of different ways. So now you can see that we got some similar results, but really privileging those reds, oranges, and yellows, right? Those warm colors. And here we go. So here's a set of variations based off of that. And honestly, I see a lot of folks do this, right? It's all about generating variations of things, right? I could always upscale one of these. Let me go ahead and upscale. Let's say this one right here. I like that one. Right. And so very, very quickly, it can be very prolific and generate a number of options, which I find really fascinating. We'll take some of these options later, and we'll use them as image prompts, and we'll even blend some of them together. But first, I think let's talk a bit more about the settings. Okay. I hope this isn't boring. I hope this is fascinating for you. It's like magic the first time you use this. So
it's fascinating, Josh.
So I use the slash. Anytime you want to bring up all the commands you can use in Midjourney, you type in slash, and then it sort of IntelliSenses what you might be using or what you've frequently used, right? And you can see all your options here, right? So we're using Imagine in order to turn a prompt into a set of images. Another one that's pretty common is Settings, right? So I'm going to Settings, and you can see that now I have a bunch of buttons. Let's just take a look at these because we can toggle certain things on back and forth. First and foremost, what you see is MJ version 1, 2, 3, 4, and Niji mode. These are the various models, right? These are the various models that underwent particular training for Midjourney. So back when Midjourney started, it was on version 1, model 1, and then model 2, and then model 3. And if this is brand new to you, this might seem kind of, I don't know, pedantic, but for a lot of us that have been using this, we've seen a lot of changes over the summertime between 1, 2, 3, and 4. It's like dramatic changes. It's sort of, and the changes have been very quick. I think we all sort of look back nostalgically. It's, you know, certain very versions and different workflows that we had developed based off of those models. And you can access all of them still here, right? So by default, I think it's going with the latest version 4, but I can always go back to version 3. In fact, you know what? I'm going to switch it over to version 3. You can see now that it's toggled as green. And I'm just going to re-enter what I did in the model 4. Let's just see the difference between model 4 and model 3. Because there usually are very clear differences. All right. So while that's going, there's other things here. There's other sort of test models. You can adjust the quality. Again, this has to do with, it just disappeared. The quality basically is just how much computing you're using on the server farm. So you just got to be careful with that. If you have a certain quota that you can only use per month and Midjourney, I have mine set to high quality all the time. And style is referring to how liberal the model can interpret or steer away from your prompt, right? So if you turn the style really low, it's going to try to strictly adhere to your prompt and not add any of this sort of special Midjourney secret sauce that it has. You can turn the crank the style up very high. And again, if you're looking for things that are uncanny, maybe a little bit fuzzier, things that you didn't intend for, the sort of non-determinate sort of results that it can give you, you can crank that style up and then you can get all sorts of surprising, counterintuitive sort of things. If you're looking for something quite literal to what you're typing, you can keep that style low. There's lots of different ways to upscale. And you can see that here's an example of the upscaling. So there we took one of these small thumbnails and it got larger, right? We can see things in clearer focus. All right. Last but not least, there's fast mode and relax mode. And I'm setting mine to fast mode just so these things go faster. Usually I'm just in relax mode. I don't really care. If it takes 90 seconds longer to generate these things, I'm usually still pretty happy. I mean, suffice to say, beyond modeling, it would take me a long time to sort of render this out and then to layer things up in Photoshop to start to achieve anything close to these results when it comes to the effects of lighting and material and surface. And so I think that's one of the things I'm really curious about with these is sort of teasing out these effects and in such like breakneck speed, honestly. you know, I've been around long enough. And Neil's probably shaking his head. Yeah, I mean, we've been around long enough to know just how painstaking some of these things can be and how computing used to be not nearly as fast as it was before. So, you know, this is quite remarkable to sort of get these results in 90 seconds or less. Unbelievable. So this is version 3 results. You can see it's much different than the version 4. All right. I'm just going to go back to my settings. Sorry, I keep scrolling back and forth, but I'm just going to go back to version 4 and just use that as my default for right now. All right. A tall interior space made from glowing glass surface, volumetric lighting. I'm just going to go ahead and copy that so I can just sort of paste it again. A tall interior space, and now I'm going to say a tall undulating interior space made from glowing glass surfaces. Let's see here. We'll just change up the geometry a bit and get something kind of wavy and see how that changes. While that's going, let me just refer back. Let me just make sure I'm not missing anything big here. Okay, yeah. So we're starting to generate things. And again, you know, trying to figure out how this works with your existing workflow or how this begins to modify your own workflows when you're just sort of ideating and trying to get how these can be incorporated in your design process, right? So you can start by just sort of a basic idea, right? You know, just kind of like your sketchbook, right? You have an idea. Instead of fumbling around for a pen in your sketchbook, you sort of thumb it out on your phone in Discord, and then 90 seconds later, you have some AI interpreted results of what you were thinking, right? So this is the same prompt with these glass, but then using the term undulating, you can see that the geometric results, the geometric features of the space have completely changed, right? So you'll start to pick up on key words and what they do or don't do here really quickly. Let me get another one going. I'm always trying to keep these things going in a sort of a production line here. A tall, we'll use angular again. Let's see what angular does. Interior space. But suffice to say, you know, we can begin to just go off the idea and see what kind of results we get. We can also feed in images, right? We could feed in images of our sketches, of our models, or start to use certain images that we get as results, and then pump those in as part of the prompt. So really quickly, I'm just going to generate a variation of this one. And I mentioned remix mode. I'm just going to go ahead and type in, or go ahead and click the version 2, right? So let's say I like this. I say tall undulating interior space made from glowing glass surfaces with volumetric lighting. But I'm also just going to change this a bit before I generate the variation. So I'm going to say, I'm just going to add a comma. I'm going to say, cool green and blue colors, right? So in this case, I just want to change a few things. I want to adjust the prompt, but I still want to sort of generate variations off of this image. So we'll see what happens there. Here we go. Now here we have angular glass instead of undulating glass. So, you know, I always find while this is working, I always find this really, you know, almost, I like to think it's kind of formulaic, but then I get surprised and then suddenly there's lots of different ways to do this. But I always find that I'm like trying to figure out how to best write a prompt. And so, you know, I sort of think about, well, what's the subject? How do I describe it geometrically? How do I describe it with the way texturally or materially? Or how do I talk about the setting or the environment or the lighting, right? And sort of, you know, so I'll start simple and then I'll iterate. I'll start to sort of build. Once I hit on certain results, then I'll start to develop a set of variations. Like, I suspect everybody has their own workflows, but that's kind of how mine works. So here we are generating variations, but this time I just added blues and greens, right? It sort of got rid of some of the oranges and pinks and sort of, you know, fleshy tones that we had in that one. Right, so I'm just going to save this. I can just click on that and save it. I'll just add it to my downloads folder, ironically. The last thing my downloads folder needs is more files in it, but nevertheless. And you can see what I'm about to do here, right? So I took an existing photograph of a metro station. Actually, this is a Harry Weiss metro station in Washington, D.C. And I sent that as a message to the bot, the Midjourney bot. And that's what it looks like. And then I used that as an image prompt here. And I gave it also the text prompt, vaulted coffered concrete interior space volumetric lighting, and sort of used that as an image prompt to then to go along with my text prompt, right? So let's just take a look at that. What I did is I downloaded this image, and what I'm gonna do, you can see here where I'm messaging the Midjourney bot, there's this plus symbol, and I can say, I'm gonna upload a file, and I'm just gonna upload this image that I just downloaded. And send it on to the robot. So now I've messaged Midjourney this image. It's there. It's sitting there. It's uploaded to its server. And if I right click on it, right, I can get its link, right? Copy link. Now when I type in imagine, right, the very front part of the prompt, I can paste that link in, right? So I can use that image as a prompt. And I can say, let's say glowing interior space made from fiber optic cables woven in a tapestry with LED lighting, something like that. I'm just sort of ad-libbing, but and don't ask me why I just, you know, really like interior spaces this morning, but so we're waiting for that. Right. And so what it's going to do is it's going to sample portions of this image. Maybe it's the color scheme, maybe it's the geometry, maybe it's the original seed, right? But we'll start to, this image will start to inform the results just as much as our text prompt informs the results, right? So you can see that there's some similarities here, although it is being adjusted and we start to get this, right. So now we're starting to get this sort of fibrous texture from, I think, my prompt saying, evoking fiber optic cabling or whatever it is that you're throwing at this. Right. So one other setting I wanted to show you, right? So we've talked about Imagine and we've talked about using Imagine with text prompts as well as image prompts. Let's use two image prompts and blend them together. If I type in slash, I use the term blend. I'm going to go ahead and click on that. It's going to ask me for two different images. I'm going to go ahead and select this one. I'm going to try to find two images that are really different, right? So here we have this sort of coffered, brutalist, concrete metro station ceiling. And here we have this sort of glowy light, glass translucent material. And I'm just going to see if I can hit enter. Let's see. There we go. And we're just going to tell them to blend those two images together and let's see what pops out. And this is really interesting because this is a way you could begin to riff off of your existing design process, right? So if you have sketches, if you have models, if you have renderings, you can begin to enter them into Midjourney and begin to blend things together. So there's lots of different ways you could begin to sort of take off of this, right? So right away, I mean, it's still, there's going to be a lot of magic here between 93 and 100%. Sometimes it really comes together at the end there, but you can see it sort of combined that sort of coffering and then the color scheme and translucency, between the sort of, the floor and the ceiling, right? So kind of bizarre, and I'm not sure I really enjoy it, but you can, those two completely different examples sort of give you a sense of how it can blend things together. And certainly it could blend disparate things together. I think that's, again, another thing. And that Barbara mentioned as well, right? You know, if your ideas are getting stale, right? I like to think of Midjourney and other diffusion models as these sort of tool that can maybe subvert how you're thinking about things, right? And I'm always looking for things that are maybe kind of weird, slightly out of focus, uncanny, et cetera, right? I think those are really productive ways of, again, challenging the way you're thinking about your design. And right, so I don't want to take too much time because I'm really interested in hearing Sarah as well. That's it in a nutshell. And, you know, just going over some basic prompting and then going over those settings. And I'm kind of curious from the digital futures team or Neil, you know, is there anything that I'm that sticks out that I'm missing?
There are some questions. There's somebody asked about how do you get the boot only for yourself? I guess because it's a paid account. Maybe you could just show that people that when they have a free account, they get into the boot with everything together. And that's why you miss your work.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
Think of the people that doesn't have an account.
That's right. All right.
Sometimes a bit lost.
So this, again, I'm still in Discord, but I moved from my private messages to the Midjourney server, right? So this is the Midjourney server. And when you first sign up, it'll take you to the welcome channel, right? And you'll see a bunch of people being welcomed. And you can see there's lots of different rooms here. And there's some that they're named general and for newbies. I'm just gonna go to general and you can see that you're in a big community channel and lots of people that you probably don't know are entering all kinds of prompts. really important. It's really important to sort of remember which room you're in if you're starting. And so I'll pick the last one here, 20. And what you're going to find is that I'm going to go ahead and type in imagine. I'll type in something. Let's say, let's see. Windy pathways, organically shaped neighborhood. Of concrete and glass housing buildings. I don't know why I'm picking on concrete and glass today, but what you're going to see is that publicly you're going to have you're in a room with a bunch of other people, and so you're going to see their stuff pop up in line with yours, which is kind of annoying, and that's why I quickly sort of message the bot. So once I generate something here, let me just wait for this to come into focus. I really kind of want to see what happens here, this prompt. But while we're waiting, you can see that I've messaged the Midjourney bot. I can click here and I can say message the Midjourney bot. Let's see if this works. If I can just send it a DM, where to go. And this is the problem.
Maybe that works because you have an account, I think, right?
Yeah, it sure does. Let's see.
It's just that maybe people that they can have
I see.
For $10 or $30, and then they can go to the private boat.
Absolutely. Here, let me show you that.
That's why you don't get crazy doing this.
I get you.
One trick way for them to get you to pay something, right?
Yeah, so that's a good point. Thank you for bringing that up. I forgot about that. So I'm back at midjourney.com in my browser. And so if I go to home and I go to settings, right? Let's see here. Sorry, maybe I have to go here.
We have more questions than I'll tell you later. Okay.
let's see. There's a way to, I don't know what it's doing here. Oh, I see. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and sign in. So this is the splash page when you're not signed in. All right. I don't know why it kicked me out, but I'll go ahead and sign in here. And I'm just trying to get to my settings page, but basically Midjourney is a subscription service. So you get a few free trials. And then after that, they require a monthly membership. And I believe there's a sort of limited membership for $8 or $10 a month, US dollars. And then, a sort of unlimited.
$10. That's my $10. Account.
Yeah. Okay. And then unlimited one for 30
generations. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So if you're interested in continually, repeating and generating and iterating, you probably want to go with a $30 account. If you can budget your monthly use, then you can go with the $10 accounts. And this is a subscription service. You know, there are other diffusion models that aren't subscription based, including Stable Diffusion, which I think Sarah will touch on here after I'm done. And so, yeah, that's a good segue maybe to Sarah if we're ready.
Well, there are some more. Just some questions, right? Yeah. Okay. From the chat.
Can I ask you just one quick question?
Yeah. Okay.
How would you characterize the difference between V3 and V4, the latest system? It seems to me they're very different, and I struggled at first with that.
Yeah. So version 3, version 3 sort of gives you, I don't know, maybe more unexpected results with an aesthetic that is maybe less photorealistic and lots of interesting sort of painterly textures. Version 4, I think, tends to try to be more photorealistic and more literal with interpreting your prompts. So I know a lot of folks that were kind of disappointed with version 4 when it came out and probably still continue to use version 3.
It's a bit like, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong here, but maybe it's a bit like V4 version 4 is a bit like DALL-E, or more like DALL-E.
Yeah.
Kristen?
Yeah, I would agree with that. Absolutely. Right. I mean, I think it with version four, like if you want certain effects, I think you have to sort of specify that in the prompt itself, right? And sort of take it out of its sort of photorealism mode, right? Version three sort of had an aesthetic sort of baked into it that was I don't know, it seemed more like a sort of sketch, right? It sort of seemed less refined and I think more open to interpretation as far as the direction you might take the results. I don't know.
I mean, one thing I found is that the version four came out quite metallic looking, and I therefore introduced no metallic into the prompt, which was a way to try and avoid that. But I think also what I noticed is that with version three, the more you iterate, so the more you use V1, V2, V3, whatever, the more you do that, the more refined it was getting. Whereas what I found before the final version is it kind of, as you iterate, you lose some of the definition. I don't know if you noticed that yourself, but.
Yeah, I have. Yeah, it's kind of interesting. You know, it's weird because the models work in different ways and no one's really quite sure what's happening in that black box. But I do notice differences in results for sure. And that's the two things that you just mentioned, Neil, I've noticed as well, right? So it seems like when you generate variations of, let's say, this, it starts to almost, you lose some of the interesting qualities that you liked. Whereas version three, it was very much sort of, I find myself iterating the prompts more in version four, whereas I found myself creating variations off the images in version three, right? So it was much more of a graphic exercise in version three and a little more of a sort of prompt writing exercise in version four. Yeah, it's weird how, you know, the tools sort of, you know, they make some adjustments and then we sort of adjust our process to try to work with them. Yeah.
And maybe just one comment I think about in terms of, actually for any designer, but for architecture, if you want to refer to an architect, you've got to find a name that is high profile, that's out there, that, you know, that is on the internet and things, but that is unusual. So a name like John Smith will not work, right? Whereas a name like Bjarke Ingels will work quite well, or indeed a building that is kind of a famous, you know, will work quite well. So you can refer to those things, but they've got to be out there. They've got to be very popular. Hence, I guess Zaha Hadid is probably much more easy to follow than other things, but it's not actually designed for architects. It's not customized for architects. And I think
Neil, just let me say one thing. On version four, they added a lot of architects' names and designers, much more than version three. So you might get lucky, not all of them, for sure, just the most famous one. But it was much better than version three. That's mine.
Do you want to read, Angelica, some of the questions?
There's one more question, from Kevin Klinger. Do you ever have to tweak the prompt to get the results? Specifically, I'm curious about tactics for aligning prompt strategies with fabrication and production, glass panel making, for instance.
Kevin Klinger. Great, I'm glad Kevin's online. To me, it's again, it's just sort of a generative sketchbook. So, you know, I'm not, you know, you can't generate G code from any of these images, but you can certainly generate lots of ideas when it comes to textures, patterns, material effects, those sorts of things, as well as to sort of come up with strange sort of mixes of scales and qualities. So, you know, to me, the question is, what kind of questions, I guess that's kind of redundant. When I use this, it usually gets me to ask better questions about what I'm thinking about design-wise. And again, I kind of default to certain ideas, I think. So when my ideas are getting stale, this sort of gets me unstuck, right? I mean, I think what's really interesting here is when you take something like, let me just scroll through, find some things I was doing the other day, right? Like you find a pattern like this and you say, well, how can I possibly make that, right? Or how can I possibly even geometrically model it, right? Is it something I need to write a script for? Can I get into Grasshopper? Do I, Are those tool marks from a router bit, or do I need to 3D print this? It's glowing. What kinds of things? You know, it's sort of. I think helps unstick me from, I guess, the what I. If you're prone to sort of think realistically, this stuff gives you stuff that isn't easily made, and isn't easily modeled. Or, you know, I'm always looking for the stuff that I can't do in 5 or 10 minutes using Rhino or Maya or something like that, right? Or Blender. I'm looking for stuff that sort of gives me more of a challenge, right? So, you know, just looking at these things. When it comes to fabrication, you know, I mean, these are just images. They're not even spatial, right? And I'm using words like glass and fiber optic cabling and stuff like that. The Fusion model has no clue what those things are, but it can draw those things, right? So I think that's what we're tapping into you know, it's kind of like a savant, right? It doesn't even understand any of these things, yet it's very good at very particular things, right? So
can I ask you one question? Sure. Did you try to change sizes? You know, when you do the blend, you can change a portrait or landscape, but there's also a way to change proportions. Have you ever tried those things?
Very good. Yes, absolutely. So if I go to, let me just type in a prompt here. And let me just copy and paste one. Glowing interior space made from here. I'll just use this. Copy and paste. Yes, thank you. I forgot to mention that. At the very end, I can actually add some settings manually if I like to. I can use the double dash. And then in this case, if I want to change the size or aspect ratio, right? There's a shortcut called AR for short.
And also talk about the null thing. You can
So in this case, I can type in an aspect ratio like 9:16, and it'll give me something like this. So here's an interesting one, right? It started to generate people in this. Let me just copy and paste this one. And I'll type in another one. I'll say, imagine. I'll copy and paste. Here we go. Volumetric lighting. In this case, I'll say no. So dash, dash, no. And then I can say, like, if I'm getting people in my images and I don't want people, or I'm getting, like, you know, a particular color and I don't want that color, I can go ahead and, like, I can say no blue tones, something like that. And let's see what that spits out. So you can begin to, again, try to gain some control over this. And again, between giving it image prompts or blending certain things together or controlling the aspect ratio or telling it what you don't want to see, right? You can begin to sort of, again, dial in and get more controlled results, right?
And there's somebody that asked about the U and the V, the upscaling and the variations. And they also, we have sometimes a remix mode, right? Can you explain again this for people that are just starting?
Sure, sure.
Thank you.
Let's see here. So, I forgot to put the slash. I'm going to just go to settings and I'll show you where that is. So I'm back in settings. I just typed in slash settings. And you can see one of these things, one of these buttons that I have pushed right now, and it's highlighted green, is called remix mode. So what that means is when I want to generate, let's say, a variation, let's say off of this one. So I'm going to go ahead and this is 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'm going to create a variation of 2. Okay. When I have remix mode on, it gives me this window and it asks me, well, do I want to change the prompt? So it's going to use this image as a prompt. And then do I want to change any of the text? So I could say glowing interior space made from fiber optic cables, woven in a tapestry with LED lighting. I can say hanging from the ceiling of a large gallery space with a dance troupe performing underneath. Right? And let's see what that does, right? I'm just going to sort of add something here and sort of see if it'll add some humans and, you know, some scaled figures and that sort of thing. So let's see what it does. But that's remix mode. So remix mode allows you to sort of make some alterations to the prompt, the text prompt, as you create variations off of the image, right? So I think that came from like a lot of complaints, like, hey, I want this image, but I like misspelled this word, or I didn't add, you know, a certain thing, or I want to just sort of riff off of it more. And so you get these sort of effects where you can begin to, yeah, here's one where starting to add people underneath. You can see there's different sort of scales here, but you can see that they're starting to add humans, and I could then begin to continue to iterate this. So I hope that answered your question about the remix mode, because that is really handy.
Another question, that's my question. I tend of writing my prompts more like, not like complete phrases with everything in it, with this and that. I just put the nouns and the qualities. And I noticed that you write like this long sentences, and you don't put at the end the image qualities. Did you don't want to use it, or do you think it's not useless? Because I got that from other people when I started, but then I never quit. I always use, I don't know, 8K or I don't know, any other image qualities at the end. Did you try them and see something?
Yes. So if I'm correct me if I'm not interpreting your question correctly, but I'm still writing sentences, and I'm using less words. So I might start to add some of those qualities at the end as I go, as I iterate the prompt. And
what I mean is, do you notice any difference of writing a complete sentence or just writing the nouns, or is it just the same, or does it get more confused? Right. When I tend to think that the book gets confused, but I put too many things on my sentences. Do you think you get it?
I try to write complete phrases only because it helps me. I have no clue how much it helps or doesn't help with the model. That's a really good question, because what you're saying is that I don't necessarily need some of these prepositions and other sort of filler words.
Yeah,
right?
And
if I just have glow, interior, fiber optic cables.
Which I find a lot, and people that are starting to use the ChatGPT to write prompts, and ChatGPT doesn't know exactly how to write prompts, but they end up with very long paragraphs. And it's too long.
I used to. So when it came to version 3, it seemed like I would write really intricate prompts. Like they would be very long. You know, you would start to, you know, the joke is, of course, people would invoke artist names like Greg Rutkowski, and or they would, you know, in the style of Zaha Hadid, like we were talking about before.
I noticed that the first words that you write are the ones that are going to catch more, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And
exactly.
There's something I think that you have to be, I was reading at the manual, if you write, if you put two dots or star, I don't remember if it's a comma or two dots, that it's going to change completely the way the image comes with the mix, where it mixed like a hot dog with it's going to be a dog feeling hot, or a real hot dog they're going to eat.
Yes. When it comes to those sort of ambiguities, you can use here. Hopefully you guys can see my prompt under here. What I'm going to do is the glowing interior space made from fiber optic cables. And let's add a hard stop with two colons in between. The next phrase would be woven in a tapestry with LED lighting hanging from the ceiling of a large gallery space. Maybe I get rid of...
It's two times two dots, right? I don't remember.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
For a hard stop. And in this case, I'm going to go ahead and do a dash dash AR for the aspect ratio. And I'll go ahead and give it a tall aspect ratio. 16:9, but in the tall direction. But yeah, I mean, like I said, I encourage people to sort of. What I found, let me just back up. There are certain words that are really expressive, and they do dramatically affect the prompt, and then of course the ordering also can affect the prompt. Both in how it interprets the sort of hierarchy of what it interprets, as well as how it combines certain things, right? When you talk about a glowing interior space with fiber optic cables, you know, is the interior space woven, or is it the fiber optic cables that are woven, right? If I'm not getting the results I want because it's misinterpreting my my intent, then I can start to switch the order of words up. And I can begin to use these hard stops with the double colons in order to sort of put certain words together and group them in certain phrases, right, that it can then sort of interpret better, right? So you can see that the results are much different. In fact, they're actually more interesting.
Yeah.
They're more spatial here.
And that comes with a last question from the chat, YouTube, Aida Zainali. Some of my renders by using Midjourney are so realistic and others are not. How can I have realistic renders?
So that's a good question. You know, you can always add things like photorealistic or taken with a, you know, large format camera, or, you know, sort of descriptions like that, trying to get the model to remember some of its training data. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, right? Like, so here, let me just, as an example, since I have this up, let me go ahead and do this, right? So let's say I could say imagine, and I go ahead and put this up, and I could say photorealistic. I'm going to go ahead and make a copy of this really quickly and hit enter. Now I'll do the same thing, but I'll say, instead of photorealistic, I'll replace it with in style of 1950s comic book illustration, right? I mean, I can't think of two completely different sort of ways of thinking about this. So if you're getting something that doesn't look photorealistic, you can try to then add descriptors at the end that start to, you know, evoke photorealism.
One good tip maybe is also to look for other people's prompts and see what you think it's worked and try, right?
Exactly.
And one thing that I do in the app, I follow the people that I like. So you can follow the ones that are open, right? And you like, you can see their prompts and everything, right?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, this is what you, if you can find me, right? This is what
I look like on the app. Now.
So now you can click on this and you can.
If you're not closed, you're not private.
Yeah.
Whenever you're not private, I can follow you.
Yep. And I think that's interesting, right? I mean, I think there's a value to seeing what the prompts are and things like that beyond a proprietary one, right? Like I think sort of learning from these things are interesting, right? So you can see that this is actually quite a silly short prompt, a monumental undulating tall interior space made from concrete volumetric light, right? And you can sort of see the parameters that were used and not used.
And the family, they show the origin of those images, which is
Let
nice.
Let me go to an archive and I can go back to when I was using version 3 more.
And only recently I found out that I can go back to that image on the booth and change it if I want by locating it on my app.
Yeah, exactly right. Right. And so, you know, you can see the difference also between version 3 and version 4, right? This is not photorealistic. And I kind of liked it not being photorealistic. But yeah, you can see where it came from. You can see its parents. You can see, you can sort of see its lineage, right? You can sort of track it back and start to understand where it came from and how you got there. This is neighborhood of organically shaped pathways and balconies in style of Bjarke Ingels, right? So I name dropped an architect there. And Bjarke Ingels, as Neil mentioned, is actually a pretty effective architect to name drop if you're going to, in order to sort of change the outputs that you get. You can see this was done in version 3, for instance. But what's really interesting is you can go back through and you can sort of see just how expansive of a design space this opens up, right? I mean, there's lots of, if you think about this as a family tree, there's lots of branches here and there's lots of splits and lots of bifurcation. As you go down this rabbit hole of just exploring one prompt and just sort of, you know, again, creating variations and breeding or blending certain results into more results, right? So I think it's pretty interesting. You can see these range from, like, you know, studies of machined wood to carving in stone to placing something in an outdoor landscape to creating, you know, something at the sort of neighborhood scale, et cetera, right? So oftentimes I'll do that. I'll take a prompt and I'll be like, it's really interesting as a courtyard, but what would it happen if I changed the scale completely and made it into a big monumental vaulted space, or made it into an object with no shape, or made it into a neighborhood, or you know, try to let it inform some sort of city building, right? So anyway, just sort of throw that out there.
Joshua, could I just ask one question myself? Yeah. I tried, since I work in Miami, there's also coral there, using coral as a in the prompt, but it came up with the color coral pink, basically. How could you avoid that problem? How could you specify you want?
Yeah, so if I wanted to do that, I would say type in magic. I'd say, let's say a complex object in the shape of coral, and then I might type in dash dash no, and then I might specify like no pink, uh-huh. like no pink tones. And let's see what happens. I never know exactly what I'm going to get out. So, but yeah, I mean, to me, it goes back to the prompt. And then sometimes, I mean, that's really interesting that you'll get like coral color. Sometimes it's a matter of just hitting on the right image option to then create a variation of, or other times you can specify certain words or not use certain words. So if I say in the shape of coral, no pink tone, so I'm not getting, that's kind of a neutral, yeah. So that's, once it came into focus, I don't see too many pinks here. So that's one way you could begin to control that. If you're getting a misinterpretation from, let's say, you know, maybe it's interpreting coral, it's a homophone for, you know, several different meanings. Then you can try to specify, like, I'm not looking at the color, I'm looking for the shape or the species or the geometry, right? So
that's great. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Yeah. So that's how I would probably approach it, just to start off with, and then going back and forth. And I don't know if it's an interesting sort of branching structure, but you know, I think what's interesting is that it really likes fractals. So you can start to generate fractal patterns quite easily.
I guess that's one of the issues. It's very good at doing some things and not as others. Yeah. And therefore you have this tendency to go in the direction of the, what we call the affordances of the technique. So it'll, and it kind of, therefore it'll, it, so it's, it can't be used comprehensively. It's more kind of there to throw out ideas because you can't really control it, but there are some things it can do and something it can't.
Yeah, absolutely. And then the other thing is, you know, if I want to recreate this image and, you know, get multiple viewpoints of, you know, vantage points of it, right? Like it, you're not necessarily going to be able to recreate this exact image again, right? So yeah, you're always sort of at the mercy of the tool. And again, what, just sort of understanding what it's capable of and what it's not capable of, right?
You know, what do you do if you want to try to find different angles? One thing that I did was to use it as an input or blend it, mm-hmm. and try to manage with the prompt. I get something similar to it, but not exactly surrounding the whole thing. But
yeah, I mean, the blending, that's what the blend tool is really nice. It's a really nice feature now. Like I said, if I'm studying, let's say, a design problem, both in terms of, you know, using AI and but also deploying materials and models and things like that, you know, I think what's nice about it is you can start to mix and match and start to, you know, I can pull in photos of models, I can pull in renderings or just screen captures of geometry that I'm working on, or even just sketches, then begin to re-render them or combine them in different ways. I think it's kind of an interesting way to riff.
You can
off
put
of your ideas.
People on your drawing.
Yeah, or add
your
entourage,
sketches.
Right? Like humans, vegetation, ambiance, yeah. Atmospherics, right? You know, the balloons floating in the sky, the birds flying around. You know, what kind of atmospherics are you looking for? Is it a, you know, a stormy dramatic sky, or is it a nice blue, electric blue? Clear sky, or you know, what the setting is an urban setting versus a natural setting, etc. Yeah, so there's lots of different ways to sort of, you know, combine these things. And again, it's sort of what I would encourage everybody to do. There's everybody, I think, finds their own sort of paths through these tools and starts to develop their own workflows. But I would just encourage everybody to sort of get online and just explore, right? And share. I think that's the other thing, right? You mentioned the app. You can close off your results on the app, but I'm not even really interested in trying to keep these things secret. I'm just typing in words and seeing what the diffusion model gives me. I'm not really trying to produce something that's proprietary here. So, I think we can learn a lot from each other. And that's why I really appreciate these sessions you put together. Because I think there's a lot that can be said from just looking at everybody's work and just sort of seeing the sort of diversity of results. I think after a while, you do start to see like certain aesthetics and results come out of the different models. But I think that then leads to the challenge of like, how do I get out of that comfort zone and start to generate new things that I don't keep things stale. So anyway.
Joshua, this has been fabulous, really, really informative and useful. I'm sure there's some other questions that might come up later at the very end, maybe the comparison between Midjourney and Stable Diffusion and so on and so on and so on. But let's bring Sarah on to do some to make her presentation. Thank you so much, Joshua.
Absolutely.
Super useful. Yeah. Thank you. Sarah.
Thank you, Joshua. I'm a big fan of your work, and it was really interesting. Thank you. I would like also to thank Digital Futures, Professor Neil Leach, Angelica, everybody behind this, because this AI series have a lot of things going in the background and a lot of efforts. So I will start my presentation. I hope you can see the screen.
Yes.
Okay, great. So first of all, I will show you a bit of my works in different platforms, in DALL-E, Midjourney, and also in Stable Diffusion and Dream Studio. So I will be starting with our tutorial today. It's actually an introduction to Stable Diffusion. I will be focusing on Dream Studio and a bit of Google Colab for people that first time ever have idea about AI. So I will be explaining a bit how it works. So the tutorial aims to introduce students and everyone interested to the basic prompt engineering and using Stable Diffusion text to image. And also I will be showing you an example in image to image and text to animation from Colab. We will focus on explaining how Stable Diffusion Dream Studio works. We will learn basic methods of prompt engineering to produce architectural outcomes specifically. We will practice multiple prompts and analyze the results, and also we'll learn a basic overview of Stable Diffusion text to animation in Colab. And we will practice an example of a notebook and share the important references, because I feel it's important to share some links. This is basically the workflow that was in my mind for the tutorial. First, we will have to start with a concept. Because as architects, we can play around with these tools, we can generate a lot of fascinating things. But if we want to talk about architecture, we will have to have some concept in mind when starting. So the topic is possibly here architecture. We can also work with 3D printing, we can work with different materials, product design. It's an open space for everyone. So we will make my suggestion, my tip or my advice to make a basic research on design projects that you are really interested in for your prompt and pick up some keywords. And when we will start in Stable Diffusion Dream Studio, we will try different prompts, redream them, and then upscale them. I usually do the upscaling in separate AI tools to upscale my images. I will explain why now. After that, we will start with a Colab notebook named KLMC2 Animation. It's different from Deform. I will explain about it also. So basically, what is Stable Diffusion? It's a deep learning text-to-image model. It's released in 2022. It is primarily used to generate detailed images conditioned on text description. It also uses other tasks such as inpainting, outpainting, and generating image-to-image translations guided by a text prompt. The model, basically, this is from Wikipedia. The models basically generates images by iteratively denoising random noise until a configured number of steps have been reached. And then it is important also to mention that it's guided by clip text encoder. It also enhances the possibilities of the image to be produced based on your prompt. I will move now to Dream Studio. So why we are working with Dream Studio? Because it's the web release of Stable Diffusion text-to-image generator. It's similar to DALL-E 2, but with key differences. Stable Diffusion source code is being an open source in different platforms, making it easy for everyone to access it, and it's also being developed. You can either log in through Dream Studio website, or they have also Discord. And they have text to image, image to image. Now I will be taking you to the main interface. This is the parameters panel. It's written here that it's Dream Studio Lite. I think it means that they have a lot of developed versions coming up. So here, if you look at the menu, Dream means that this is the key that you press to produce your prompt into images. The history is very important because it saves everything that you do. And you will have to be careful that you will not clear your cache because all of your images will go. So make sure you download your image after producing it. And also the prompt guide is very important. You should definitely go there and read and download their PDF about prompt engineering methods. The social is their social media platforms, and also the questions and answers is very important that you to enter there. We'll talk about credits. So every new user have 100 free credits. I think this is more clarifying. So you get 100 free credits. You will have to be careful with the credits because some images might take a lot of credits and not produce a good results. This table, actually, you found it in the questions, and it explains precisely how you spend your credits. So it's basically, it's about steps and about the image size. So whenever you change the width and the height, you will pay more credits, and also with the steps of the image. CFG scale is very important. As you read, it's about how much the image will be like your prompt. But there is a thing here that in architectural outcomes and other outcomes, we shouldn't use a high CFG scale. Otherwise, we will get an irregular or not really accurate images. Number of images. By default, there are four, but I work usually with one to make sure that I got the results that I want without spending too much time. Also, there is the sampler and the model, and this is the clip guidance that I talked about in the first slides. So whenever you turn off the clip guidance, you can use the sampler that you want to choose, and you can also try different Stable Diffusion models. Actually, from my experience, Stable Diffusion, this version V1.5 is like it works with most of the prompts. But whenever you try to go with another version and you play with a sampler, maybe you will get some conflict in your results. So this one is to produce image from image. Basically, you upload an image and you try to inpaint or mask some parts or delete some parts and replace them with a prompt that you will write. I will be showing you some results. So first, we talked about determining the concept. We will have to know that AI is a great tool, and it's also a great tool for architecture projects. So if we have a very clear concept, we can change, produce a lot of good outcomes out of it. I will work on three concepts in this tutorial: a unique mass of a library, which is an exterior scene, a mega pavilion hall from the interior scene, and ephemeral installation in the city center. I will work on this both on Dream Studio and also on Colab. So the key points we're focusing on is having the lightning, the material, and high performance. And also, as I said, it helps that you extract some keywords from projects that you like, whether it was a patron, maybe you read an article on Arc Daily and you like the project and you want to make something. So you extract the right keywords that they use to describe their design, and it can help in your prompt writing. So how do we write a prompt? The prompt have different parts or multiple parts. We have the core prompt, we have the style, we have also the name of architect or artist, and we have the finishing touches. And also there is something called prompt weightening and negative prompting. So this is written in the prompt guide. You can find it in Dream Studio. For the prompt weightening and the negative prompting, it's a very joyful process, but I think it's a bit an intermediate level, so we will not go in there much. So I wrote an examples of a prompt. We will see what does this prompt have from the elements that we mentioned. A hyper-realistic, demetric exterior perspective view of a mega library in the city center. So this is the core prompt, and the style is hyper-realistic because I want it like this. We can type sketches, we can type painting, oil painting, whatever we want to specify our style. The second example is also a hyper-realistic, demetric exterior perspective view of a mega library in the city center designed by Antoni Gaudi. So we have mentioned the architect name here. So this is a very nice graph to get to know which projection you want. I didn't experiment with them all, but I used this demetric and also the curvilinear 2-point and 1-point. And also the isometric, and it gives really good results to specify your style. And also you can specify a wide angle by just typing wide angle. Okay, so as we can see here, this is the first result of the prompt that I wrote, a hyper-realistic, demetric perspective exterior view of a mega library in the city center. So we have 30 steps and the CFG scale, which is defining how the algorithm is responding to your prompt, was 7, which is considered a medium rate. So here we just have different steps between two images. In this image, it's the same prompt, but we have more steps and more CFG scale. So the result is a bit better. This is the second example where we mentioned Antoni Gaudi, and we have a lot of, like, we produced a high CFG scale and high steps. So whenever you mention Antoni Gaudi, that means a lot of curves and details. So you will have to be careful how to play with steps and also with scale. This is quite interesting. Hyper-realistic, demetric exterior perspective view of a mega library in the city center designed by Antoni Gaudi. So basically I get a city view and I get the material that is really accurate. And I didn't mention the material, but because we mentioned Gaudi, and we have a high steps, 99, and we have a CFG scale, a high CFG scale. So it depends on your prompt. Whenever you mention, also on the style of the architect you are mentioning, so it differs. So we have the third example here, a hyper-realistic, demetric exterior perspective view of a mega library in the city center designed by Antoni Gaudi, made from timber and steel, parametric perforated facade, realistic, and also the final touches, HQ, 8K cinematic render. I like to use cinematic render because the colors are really good and realistic. So this one is very long and with a lot of details. We will see the result now. The one down there, we have extracted the details about the material, and we just want to say that it's just designed by Antoni Gaudi, and we added the final touches. So this is example three, where we added the material and we added the word facade. So whenever you write facade, it will be a bit complicated, especially if you have high steps, as I did, and you have a high CFG scale as well. So not a very good result. This is example four. We didn't mention here about the material. We only added the final touches, and it starts to give something related to Gaudi and an exterior render and something close to my prompt. So this is the best one, I think, from what I did, because I have to higher the steps. Here we have 33 steps and here we have 90 steps, and we have a high CFG scale as well. And I like how the material and the curves, and we have a new style of Antoni Gaudi, actually. So I have a small conclusion here that I can share with you. The short prompt is really good in Dream Studio. We have to specify our view always, and we have to specify whether it's interior or exterior. The architect name is possibly important, as we see that it gives us the style. If we are seeking something like Zaha Hadid or Antoni Gaudi, we should mention that in the prompt in Dream Studio. Some platforms, you don't need to mention that. You just have to mention some keywords related to architect's work. And also the high CFG and high steps will make you a good results. On the other side, if you mentioned a short prompt, and specified your view and specified the architect name, but you have multiple materials and details, and you mentioned facade and you mentioned a lot of things, possibly you will get an irrational result. And this one also, the same stuff, but you add finishing touches, medium CFG, high steps, as we've seen in the examples, so you have a good results. The diffusion models and the seeds, I will be talking about them briefly. Diffusion models, we have stable diffusion is really developing, so there are a lot of diffusion models. You just have to know how to balance them. Stable diffusion too actually works well with architectural works, but also you have to, it depends on your prompt. So you have to disable the clip guidance to be able to open the diffusion models. For the seeds, we can do a lot of things in the seeds. You can, each image, as we've seen before in the example, have their seed number. So you can simply copy the seed number and you can go to here and you can uncheck this, and you don't have to uncheck this. You can write it here right away and you can write your prompts, and the results will be really good. So this one about the sampler and the model, I will show you how it can give an unexpected results. It's going to be quick. So we have the sampler, which is the another sampler. We have chose the sampler number one, DDIM, stable diffusion 1.5. And this is the result. We will change the model now. Okay, this is really weird because it's completely different. So this sampler and this model did not work in this prompt. Yeah. So this is the idea. About the seeds, you can generate advanced iterations from another image seeds. You have to go to your history, choose the image that you like, copy the seed, and just paste it and redream your prompt again, so you get a very nice result. This is really great. Okay, so working on the second concept that I talked about, it's a mega pavilion hall. It's an interior scene. So a hyper-realistic curvilinear, I have changed the projection, curvilinear perspective view of a mega interior ellipse pavilion, intricate fluid bent aluminium structure and threads of blue lead glow, long exposure, realistic, and also the final touches that I add to each image. Actually, I had a bent and a fluid form and also an ellipse form, but I don't see much of a steel maybe in this image. But I think it responds more to the exposure word and the light word. And I like the results of this one. This one is also generated with sampler 4. And also it gives a very good results, but not with the structure. We don't see any structure here. We just see exposure. So this one for the third concept, an ephemeral installation in the city center. So an exterior perspective view of a pavilion podium in Barcelona city center, combining arabesque and origami laminations, long exposure LED and glow, serial plane, realistic, and the final touches, the cinematic render, sunset, and people. So this is a bit complicated, like a prompt, but I like the first result. The second and third results, and while I'm redreaming and changing things, are a bit, I can't see the origami that I asked for, but I can see also scenes from Barcelona city. So this is interesting. This one also, a second example, a curvilinear perspective view of a street pavilion inspired by desert waves in the city center, long exposure, people walking, laminations, and the final touches. So also, when I said curvilinear, it eventually have to give me a curvilinear view of that pavilion. So this was also generated from, let's make sure it's the same prompt. No, I added something here. Okay, so again, I will read it. A curvilinear perspective view of a street pavilion inspired by desert waves in the city center, parametric patterns by Gaudi, long exposure and people walking laminations. So I added parametric patterns. So when I changed the sampler from automatic to DDM, it produced a very different pattern, and it's interesting. So this is the third one of our examples. I think this one is the best. I was looking for a similar thing. So by medium steps and medium CFG scale. And also with the seed of the previous one. Okay, let's move to the image to image. You have to upload your image. You have to press the show editor and then upload your image here, and you can start playing with the brush that you will use, and you will start to like to know what to do with it. So this is an example. I generated this podium. It was empty, so I was like a bit disappointed with it. I want to do something different. So I wanted to do a pavilion from, I specified a material from wood designed by Zaha Hadid. I want something really hyper. So I got this at first, but there's no wood, so specifying the material is not really helping. Also, I tried to type it in a different way. Please don't mind my Grammarly. Let's see the result here. Oh, okay. So I think it's in the next one. Oh, yeah. Let's see this. Yeah. So whatever I draw, it merges the two images, as we can see, and it's really good. You have the same scene, the same elements in the picture, the same buildings, and you just generated your pavilion really easily and with no time. And this is what we are looking for. Here's another iteration from Zaha Hadid also. So let's get to Collab. I'm trying to cover as much as I can, but it's also for introductory level. So it will be joyful if you play with those settings and generate your own concepts. So for Google Collab, it's collaboratory. It's an online web interface that will allow you to write, run, and share code in Google Cloud. You can run it in your browser, so there's no need to download it. The Collab documents are called notebooks, so we know where the word notebooks come from. And they are made of cells which combine live code, equations, narrative text, graphics, and images. So to run it, you will have, of course, internet connection, Google account, and also a good RAM on your PC. Mine is 16 giga, so I think it works well. So for the Stable Diffusion notebooks, Stable Diffusion have multiple notebooks in Google Collab. So the Deform is the most, I think, a lot of users are using Deform now. It's very common. It generates 2D and 3D animation videos from image frames and multiple prompts with advanced settings to control video scenario. So it have a lot of settings, advanced settings. For the Stable Diffusion KLMC2 animation that I have chosen for you today, it actually hallucinates. I don't know the word, but it's exactly describing what is happening. And the iterations of the same seed basically gradually evolving the same forms with some slight changes in it. And you have to write one prompt, so it's not a complicated process. And also we have Stable Words notebook, it generated environments. And you can also visit some of the references that I will share, or just Google it, or type Google Collab Stable Diffusion notebooks, and you'll have to read about them and choose your favorite. So getting into the interface, first you have to sign in to your Google account. You will have to enter the link of this notebook, and I will be sharing it also to so you can directly enter there. So this is the author of the notebook. And it's sponsored by Stability AI, and it's licensed. Some authors, like, you will have to know the author before you enter, because you're sharing your drive information here. So there is a play button here. You have to play it each cell you find in the notebook. It's very important. Otherwise, you will not be able to generate your animation. So also, this is a quick process of how it works. So it's connecting here. Once you are connected, you will see the RAM and disk of your PC, and you will have to run each cell individually until it's done and you see the green check. That means that you are all set and you can, you know, continue in the process. This will take a bit of time, but like, you can just make sure that you run them all.
Sara, sorry, okay. I don't know if you said, do you copy it on your drive or just run it on the web?
Some notebooks, you should connect them to your drive. It's optional. They ask you if you want that or not. But this one, you can directly run it from your browser.
Okay, thank you.
Sure, you're welcome. So yeah, let's talk a bit about prompting. So here I wrote a prompt about similar to the prompt that I showed you in the images before about an ephemeral structure in a city center. But I wanted to say some like changes. But as you see here, nothing changes. And also, I will be showing you the settings of the prompt after this. So it's pixelated because of, I think, the slides of the online slides. Okay, let's get back a bit to just tell you about the settings. Yeah, I think I'll just cover this here. Yeah, so let's stop it for a bit. Yeah, so we have multiple settings here. After you write your prompt, you have to specify some settings that it's very important. First, we have the end number, which is how is the prompt really working with the algorithm to produce your video. You have, I think most of the time I work with the default settings, but you can make a very slight changes in it. And it's important to mention that down there in the parameters cell, there is this method, which is always have to be fake, because whenever you change it, a lot of bad results you will get. So let me show you this one. The prompt was a perspective street view of a 3D printed parametric pavilion in London City. I like to specify the city because I think it's good at generating the city scene. Silk and steel, 2-point perspective, changing its morphology as a dancer, evolving in a solid form and all of that. So it might show like a slight changes on the form. And at the final form, you will see that the material like disappeared, and it's more as a GRC structure. So this is 300 frames generated. For if you generate like more frames, the more accuracy you'll get, the more you know, resolution, the more details, and it's best to show in a very simple way in your prompt how you want this to the form of this to change. So this is another one, a curvilinear perspective view of a pavilion podium in the middle of Barcelona city neighborhood. The pavilion changed from cube to fluid morphology, silk and glow laminations, realistic render. This is shorter and less details, so and more frames. So I think this result is slightly good. And yeah, as I said, try to use the default settings in this notebook with some slight changes, mostly in G number, which is the similar to CFG scale in Dream Studio. Also, there's an important note that that happened to me. Whenever you have a problem with your RAM and you cannot make the video after you generated all those frames, just imagine that you are not connected to Google Drive and you have generated like more than 600 frames and you really need them. When you press play and make the video, you will get a green check that you have the video, but you cannot download it. So you can press here and go to your files and then search for the video in here, and you can right click on it and download it. So that will solve the problem in this notebook. This is the final one that I did. It was 600 frames, 20 seconds. The resolution is way better than this, but I think because it's playing online, it's kind of blurry. But it's really a good change in the form and something I really wanted to see from this prompt. So those are the references that I used, the links. I'd like also to share it with everyone. Thank you so much. I hope I didn't take too long, and I hope this is helpful for you all.
Sarah, thanks so much. That was incredibly helpful. Thank you. You're a natural born professor. I don't know if you're teaching yet, but you have to start teaching because you really explained things super clearly, and it was packed full of information.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sarah. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. I don't know if we have any questions for Sarah. So I think it'd be nice to just have a little bit of a general discussion at the end to kind of like to just talk about these things and maybe bring Joshua in. And also, I don't know whether whether Barbara would like to join us or not, to just talk about things. But I've got a general sort of question, which is really, you know, we've been, I guess, playing around with these things, right? And we've been discovering what we can do with these tools. The question now becomes, so I'm able to ask this both to Barbara in the fashion industry and also to Sarah and Joshua working within in the realm of architecture. What role will these tools play in the design process? How will they change our way of operating? I think Joshua made the point that these are just simply sketching tools. I like the way they open up the possibilities of what we might do. I'd like to say, well, maybe we write the prompt, but they prompt us because they come up with these suggestions and open them up. But they are at the moment just simply sketching tools. But how do they change how we will operate or how we are operating? I think that is the kind of crucial question. So I'd like to hear, I don't know, Barbara, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'd love to know that, I'd love your view as well as from the kind of architectural viewpoint from Sarah and Joshua.
Okay, fashion was the first one using AI, the first, because fashion is always on stage. So now on Fashion Week, you can see some things made exactly with AI, little collection capsule, new things. If you see Moncler, that is a big label, he has done now for Fashion Week, the advertise all made with AI. So we don't know exactly how to develop, but we want to. So we are moving around and we are working for this. I am working on a big project to stabilize AI because the problem is we don't have control. So we want more control because fashion, you know, need particulars, details. So we must have this. So I am trying to mix Midjourney with Stable, with I don't know what, because you know, everything is very fast. So we have to stay online always and go and do and try. And then I believe in this. I'm sure we can. We can do research, for example, research specific, something very, very specifically for each label. They ask for us something and we can do something very new, not going looking for old things and or books or videos or movies. No, nothing of that. Now we can do a research with new things. So this is fantastic for me. And then we will see, but I think, yes, we can do. We can do a lot.
Maybe I can just ask you a follow-up question, Barbara, because in the fashion world, you have two different worlds. You have the kind of the fashion catwalk, the haute mode, you know, and then you have the, what you buy in the shops. I'm assuming that maybe it's the former, the fashion, the kind of the catwalk thing that is really going to benefit from this new invention.
Yeah, for sure, because we can do catwalk in a digital way, online, something very new, very fast, to make little collections in the middle between a big collection and another big collection. We can do something like the resort, you know, now they have this new, the capsule, the resort. They found something to sell. And I hope also this can help also the shops and the commercial lines, because they need something new. Because, okay, we know that big labels can, they have a lot of money, so they can do everything they want. But the little labels also can have something new. I don't know exactly, okay? It's impossible to say now, but I have collaboration with the people that make shoes or people that make jewelry. And also a company in Brazil, they asked for me the covers for the new catalogs. So they are not big companies, okay? They are little reality. And I like to work also with them because they need something new, not always the little thing with something boring.
Yeah, I guess it's the magazines like Vogue and all those ones.
Yeah,
where there's another forum where you can really push these ideas right on the front cover and really have an impact on the world.
The magazines are very, very interested. And I had three collaborations with three magazines, one in Tokyo. Tokyo was the first one. Japan was the first one taking AI with a lot of interest. Then two in America, and I am very happy because they love this. But it's not finished, the old generation, okay? Photographers can be quiet and do their work, and models also. We are something different, like Photoshop when it came, okay? We are only another instrument to do something new and revolutionary, something magic, a bit magic.
Absolutely. Your work is particularly magical. So thank you.
Thank
Barbara.
You very much.
Maybe I could ask Joshua and Sarah to kind of to comment from a more architectural perspective on how you think these tools are going to change how we operate.
Sure. So, you know, I think there seems like there's two things like right now, right up front. One is that I think because these are language models that we're dealing with, you know, they really are a really interesting sort of extension of our intellects. Like we're forced to like express things in words. It's like the first time I've seen my students want to iterate their writing, like about their ideas behind their design work. And so it's sort of this interesting back and forth between language and the visuals. But two, you know, I think there's always been a steep learning curve when it comes to sort of integrating digital technologies into the design process. You know, I don't think the know-how has gotten like easier until now. Like, for instance, I'll give an example, right? Instead of having to download lots of plugins and sort of, you know, really sort of trial and error my way through things, like right now I can go to ChatGPT and I can ask it to script something for me. And if we can break down those barriers, that's a big game changer. I've seen lots of folks now plugging in ChatGPT into Grasshopper, for example, to write a custom C# script node for them, right? A module. And so those sorts of things, I think if we can sort of make it more accessible, then, you know, like say anybody can start to leverage computational design tools. I mean, I think that's a real game changer. Like I think that in itself is a real sea change. What comes in the future, who knows? I think these things will get better and we'll maybe we'll start to sort of be locally trained on our own workflows and things like that. But you know, right now, just these general language models are pretty interesting in that they just keep pumping in more information to them. And it's so they're scalable in that way, which is really fascinating. They're getting closer and closer to what they would, I think the Holy Grail would be a sort of general intelligence model. They're not there yet, but they're finding that these language models are fairly resilient and sort of absorbing information and then doing unexpected things. So I think it's the future is now for sure.
Yeah, it's just not evenly distributed, perhaps I forget whose quote that was, but just one thing. I mean, so the question, the question would be is whether, I mean, what's happening, we can see on Instagram already, there is a new forum for display. There's a new form of practice, shall we say, or experimental practice, and everyone is presenting it there and probably others as well. I'm not on Facebook, but probably there as well. So there's something new happening, you know, and we got to see Barbara's work from that. I was blown away when I first saw Barbara's. I said, who did this? This is incredible. So there's something new happening, which is really special, and it's inspiring us all and so on. But the question would be, how does this enter into the typical architectural design practice? I mean, the question in a way relates back to, say, let's say the invention of photography. Does photography displace painting, or does it become a new genre that simply adds to the number of genres that we have? Is this going to take over, or is it a kind of a just a form of experimental practice? Yeah.
I think it's just a matter of time. Maybe Sarah knows more, but you know, I think it's just a matter of time before, you know, two-dimensional becomes three-dimensional, or you know, there are already like, you know, neural radiance fields where you can take, you know, AI-infused photogrammetry and very limited two-dimensional data and start to create three-dimensional data. So, you know, I think the question is, Well, I think there's several questions, but I guess maybe the more important one I would say is, when do architects or fashion designers or, you know, the sort of creatives become more involved with how to shape the tools? You know, I think that's really important. Like right now, I feel like we're consumers, except for some of the more open source products like Sarah was going over, right, with the Google Collab notebooks. So, you know, I mean, to me, that's the question is how open source and how many seats at the table do we have to try to directly influence how these things evolve and to make them useful for us instead of sort of maybe co-opting them into our process. I think co-opting is really interesting, but at a certain point, I think we need to have some input into the process more.
Before I bring Sarah, can I just follow up one question, Joshua? I guess what I'm trying to think about is, let's say the typical designer-client relationship, and probably the same goes for the fashion world. I think what now we're in a situation whereby a client will say, well, can we give us a kind of designer sketch or a conceptual, whatever it is. And in the past, that would take 2 weeks, maybe, or whatever, or maybe 4 weeks, and you have one. Now, in a matter of a few minutes or an hour at the most, you could generate multiple sort of things. So that automatically is changing, giving the client the choice immediately is automatically changing the kind of typical process.
Even one step further, the client might have Midjourney and come and say, this is what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Right?
He might ask for it.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what happens when those things sort of collapse. I suspect that really talented, good architecting will still exist, right? But I suspect it requires an open mind and a lot of communication, right? I mean, you know, to me, it's just another form of communication back and forth between, let's say, a client's needs and wants and desires, right?
I
think it starts happening because yesterday in our Arabic session in Digital Futures, we had an Egyptian architect and he said that his client requested images from AI, that he wants that work, and they try to do a realistic works but using AI. So the client asked for that. That's very interesting.
Maybe I could also what in the fashion industry does that the same thing, that maybe the clients are the relationship with the I guess the labels and things, are you able to throw out many more ideas? That does it change the way you operate, Barbara?
Yeah, a lot, because we are very fast with AI. So we can do more things and suddenly reach the clients with his desire, with his own idea. But then we have to translate in reality. So the time for projecting perhaps is faster, but then we have more time to realize, and then perhaps the things will be more beautiful or more detailed. So if we can take time for the realization, is correct, is good for us, because we have more time to do the things and less time to work on this, because work on drawings, on sketches, and try is very hard. With AI, we can see now what is the result wearing a thing. So this is something very important for us. Yeah, it's very nice, but people doesn't understand now exactly what AI is. Also photographers or models, photographers came to me and say, oh, what a nice photograph. Who is the photographer? There is no photographer. There is no model. There is nothing. There is no clothes. Oh, someone asked for me to organize a runway in Brazil with my clothes. Oh, thank you very much, but you have to produce first, because they are not true. They can be true, but now they are not, of course. So people must know what AI is. Now we are only, wow, an explosion. And I hope they will understand and not hate, because there are a lot of haters. I don't know you guys in architecture, if you have haters, but we have a lot. Okay.
We have that too. I mean, that's so, but I think it's, in the moment, it's maybe a bit extreme. You get the haters and those who uncritically promote AI. And I think we need to kind of understand it properly and fully. I guess that there is a question, of course, in the sense that, you know, I mean, it is a useful tool and you could do amazing things with it right now. But the problem is that that the clients can also do it, and they also are not going to pay so much for us to do our background research. So I can see certain areas actually being shrinking. At the same time, to pick up on what Joshua was saying, I still think there's going to be a role for the very famous designers, so the fashion label designers, and in architecture, let's say the Zaha Hadids of architecture, where you're paying extra to go and do that, especially to get that personal touch. But it, for sure, it is going to change the way that we operate, for sure, in terms of the two different disciplines. I just maybe a kind of comment for Joshua in particular. How does it change education? How does it change the way that we should be teaching, and not just architecture, but every form of discipline?
That's what I'm trying to figure out. So, you know, we know it's going to affect our students. We know it's going to affect our you know, our recent graduates. It's going to affect everything. The question is how disruptive is it going to be, and how quickly. And so, you know, when it comes to education, I have some colleagues that are scared to death of ChatGPT, and it's like, well, you know, maybe you just need to redesign your crappy writing assignments, you know, if you can be fooled by a ChatGPT bot at the moment. But at the same time, I think it's up for us to pick up these tools and try to understand them and try to come to terms with them. And there's going to be some messiness along the way, but just sort of saying, here's what's out there right now. Here's what they're capable of doing. Here's what they're incapable of doing. How can we use them or misuse them in interesting ways? I think, you know, if we think of them not as the enemy, but think of them as creative media, right? I think that goes a long way. You know, I get a lot of haters too, unfortunately. I think we all do, right? Like, I think there's always those people out there that just want to be haters. But, you know, I think it would be, the profession can't bury its head in the sand here. We have to be proactive in sort of thinking about these as creative media. That's why I'm so fascinated to, you know, when I meet someone like Barbara, or I see all the folks that Neil brings online here, I've sort of, you know, in other social media circles, you know, I'm starting to like sort of meet people from Hollywood and other sort of places, you know, these sort of kindred spirits, but sort of spanning a lot of different disciplines and industries. But what we all have in common is we're sort of looking at this and going, you know, these are new tools. How do they begin to promote sort of new sensibilities about new media, creative, you know, new ways of sort of working and new outputs, right? So I'm not, again, I'm, you know, when I come to it, I sort of look at the students and go, well, you know, it's kind of lazy if you use it to do something that you could easily do anyway, right? How do we push this and sort of think about a new sort of architecture in this case, you know, that's really is sort of AI informed, right? Or diffusion model informed, I guess, in this case.
No, absolutely. Maybe I could just untend the education thing. I mean, one thing I've noticed, and it was, I mean, maybe because I've been teaching at FIU, I teach a course on a kind of theory of AI, and I give my students an assignment, and it's on the dark side. It's called a Black Mirror episode. And this in October, one of my group of my students came up with this thing, which actually was absolutely completely generated by AI. So in other words, they used, not before ChatGPT, but they used a prompt to generate some text. They then used AI again to do a kind of voiceover to speak it out, as it were, the text. And they also used Midjourney and DALL-E to provide images alongside that. Now, that's the reality of what you can do now. Now, either you're in denial and say, no, you can't do that, or you say, okay, use AI and see what you can do with that assignment. And it seems to me that is the way forward. But the other issue that it does raise is, frankly, if the whole design process becomes much quicker and much more precise and so on, do we need 5 years to teach architecture? Do we need, I don't know how many years for fashion design, do we need so long?
Yeah, exactly. And regarding architectural education, I don't know if you have the same, but first year students have basic design one, basic design two. They have a whole studio trying to sketch and make models, and they fail and they cry and all of this happens. So they're trying to understand forms, basic forms. So if we used AI to make it more simpler, more faster, more to give students some confidence and just like let them try different ideas, let them do like maquettes or models with their hands, but with AI image generated, I'm just like imagining things. But this might help. I mean, like it's not really far away from reality or from education, I think, in my opinion.
Beyond education, I mean, it makes me wonder, well, professionally, you know, what is AI capable of versus, and how does that free us up to do the things that we actually like doing, right? The architecting part of this rather than the sort of management sides of things. Or, you know, if you think about architecture as a sort of complex negotiation of a lot of competing concerns, you know, how can AI become that sort of soft machine, you know, that architecture machine that, you know, Negroponte talked about a long time ago, right? Like, it's really kind of an interesting, fascinating thing. Like, what are the roles? Is it an interlocutor? Is it a partner? Is it a tool? You know, I, the boxes are kind of weird and maybe are outdated, but, you know, it's going to change things. The question is just how quickly.
I mean, I think it's a tool that augments what we can do, for sure. But I think that is the kind of fascinating question, is that somehow this Pandora's box has been opened and there's no going back. It's here, right? The question is, how do we engage productively? Barbara, do you want to say something?
It's absolutely impossible to stop now, because the Pandora's box, as you said, is open now and he has a lot of resonance. So now we have it and now we want to use it, because it's fantastic using it, because we are surprised every moment from AI. And like Sarah said, okay, now we can go faster. We can do a lot of things that doing manually is very hard. But to do fashion, you must know how fashion is to do. To do this one is not only a drawing or a sketch or a picture, is knowing the fabric, knowing how to stitch, knowing everything. So the school needs, and also people need to understand what is fashion, not AI has done the magic and in 5 minutes we have a collection. No, you must understand. It's like kitchen, okay? You have to put all ingredients and wait the time the things is cooked. The same, okay? Right, the same. We only have another way to approach and to do the research and find new things. Wonderful, find new things. This is the reality now. And the future is here, is now, like said Joshua.
It's just we've got a few questions in the from the channel from the chat, which we'll ask in a second. I just want to ask Sarah a follow-up question. I mean, so Sarah is from Syria, and an incredible challenge is operating as a Syrian these days. I had an amazing Syrian student a while back, Adi, so I know how good Syrians could be, but it's difficult to be. Does this open up more opportunities for those from, let's say, less advantaged backgrounds? Or is it the
opposite? Yeah, of course it opens a lot of possibilities. If we're talking about professional practice or education, which
education,
thing in
education?
Education, yeah, of course it opens a lot of possibilities because our education process for architecture, for example, in Syria is really long. It's 5 years and you get to learn a lot of things in architectural engineering. And you spend a lot of time in failing with the studios. It's hard to it's not easy. And it's very good at point because they teach you how to be like a complete architect. But at the same time here, I see the potential of AI because we need also worldwide to spread this. Everyone should hear about AI. Everyone should practice it and use it. And it's almost like it doesn't cost much because you can experiment with multiple platforms for free. And even if you want to pay for it, I think here we can find some restrictions in Syria, but there's a lot of free open platforms. Everyone can participate. And this is also a pleasure for me to be speaking here with Digital Futures and just, and I'm from Syria and everyone like watching me from Syria can also do the same thing that I did and even better also.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you from Syria. I think you've been a fantastic role model for female students,
Thank
especially
you.
From your part of the world. And I guess what you're saying
Thank
is
you
maybe
so
that some of the rendering engines that we've had in the past and things have been expensive, and it's a way of maybe you can actually access that kind of world much more cheaply. Yeah, we've got a couple of questions from Billy. Billy, it's one for Sarah. Do you think that AI is the beginning of the beast in the book of Revelations? I don't know what that question means. I guess is it the devil, I guess.
It's not at all. It's how you use it. It's how you you have your own like style and workflow. You have your concept. You're really focused on the content that you want to create using AI. So it's not a threat at all. It's here to help us, to make us more, let's say like fast, and it help us in creating our businesses and our work and in everything if we want to have a general look at it. So it's really a good and it's a tool to help, not to take over you. In any sector or any specialization.
There's another question from YouTube. How can we monetize these outputs since a lot of these kinds of digital are coming very fast? How can we monetize these things? I don't know. I got somebody approached me for an NFT, to buy mine as an NFT, and I didn't follow that up and things. But what I would say is this is an interesting story, but a true but interesting story. One of our Digital Futures team from our Poland team, Ola, was doing some experimental planes, aircraft, online, interiors and exteriors and things, and just playing around with Midjourney. And she's now been commissioned to do the interior of an aircraft, which is an amazing, wonderful story in some ways of what could happen there. I think the one thing also I would just say is that I think that it's, and this platform itself is maybe evidence of that, of bringing Barbara along, who's from the fashion and then two from architecture, is that actually in some ways, it might be sort of breaking down some of the silos, as it were, these different disciplines, and opening up a kind of a discourse, a debate between these different disciplines. One of Barbara's compatriots, Paola Antonelli, who is the Museum of Modern Art in New York, she made this comment, and she's trained as an architect at the Polytechnic Politecnico di Milano, but she takes the view that actually architecture is just part of a broader spectrum of design. And one could say the same for fashion or for industrial design or for product design. We're actually all in the world of design. And it seems to me that what these technologies are promoting is a kind of a dialogue between these different sort of disciplines, and something that I think is an incredibly rich and inspirational. And I just think that Barbara's work today has just blown me away in terms of the inspiration about what, how can we bring that into the world of architecture. I don't know whether that's I don't know whether Barbara, because you're we've had to Joshua and Sarah from architecture, whether you learned something from the architects today that you could bring into the world of fashion? Yeah,
we can, of course. We can do everything in the world of fashion, but not only fashion as we know, like the runway or the big thing. Also in fashion, in the little ones, for advertising, for the magazines, for the little shops also, because they can do something new perhaps with AI by themselves, and making perhaps, I don't know, some pictures of their clothes on different models, because a little shop cannot have a top model, okay? Can have only a model, or perhaps the daughter or the niece, I don't know. But now they can have also a top model, like a top model, but not true, wearing his dress. So this is fantastic. You know, when 3D came out, fashion tried to enter in this, but 3D as a terrible thing is so slow to do. It's fantastic, the result, but is so little, but we are very fast. So I wait for the next thing, that is AI more 3D. I want this to make videos, to move. Okay, I want to move my dress, my clothes around. And this is, for me, I think in 4, 5, 6 months, we can have it, perhaps.
Sarah or Joshua, do you comment on that?
Well, I like borrowing. So like, you know, when I'm just playing around on Midjourney, you know, I like to ask a question like, well, can I make an architecture out of cloth? Can I make an architecture out of something maybe seemingly disparate, right? Completely unrelated, or maybe mix up the scales, right? So I start to think about tapestry, right? Start to think about the organic geometries of, you know, clothing that fits around bodies, right? So, you know, I think things that were really difficult to deal with now can be visualized so quickly, and without having to sort of deal with geometrically modeling everything, you know, and simulating physics and all that other stuff, right? I think that's where these tools are kind of really fruitful right now, like just doing things that are maybe counterintuitive, or you can start to borrow and mix and match things, right? You know, borrowing from fashion to try to make architecture, trying to borrow from architecture to make a spatial fashion, right? You know, or you know, starting to look at other sorts of fields to sort of think about, you know, things that move or are dynamic in certain ways, right? Like, I think that's a really interesting thing that allows us tools like Stable Diffusion, Midjourney allow us to do so quickly. So that's one of the things I really appreciate, right? Sort of thinking about, well, how, you know, how can I be inspired when I look at a magazine cover that's dealing with fashion, you know, whether it's a particular material or a particular effect or a particular shape or geometry or color or texture, etc. Right? You know, to me, I think we can sort of borrow and use or misuse things in really interesting ways, and combine them in ways that we maybe not even thought of.
Yeah, I mean, just maybe for Barbara, it's worth saying there are a few fashion designers who Hossein Chilian was actually trained as an architect, and I'm sure there's it works the other way around. There are a few fashion designers that became architects, you know, I think this is, to my mind, I think, Joshua, what you were talking about, and you also were talking about these different sort of family trees, there is a kind of biological metaphor going on here, crossbreeding. And I think that is the thing that really I find fascinating in terms of the prompts. I mean, I often put orchids in my prompt to see what happens when you do an orchid chair, you know, and it just comes up with something extraordinary. And I think it's that extrapolation, which is opening up possibilities. We're no longer confined by the limited silo in which we operate, but we can open up and crossbreed things. And I think that biological metaphor is something that is really, really very powerful.
The latent design space just keeps growing. It's amazing.
I think like this is also happening in Stable Diffusion Deform. Notebook that you get to create your animation, and you place your multiple stages of prompt, and you specify your keyframes, and you get a really amazing results, a whole movie with your own scenario. So this is really interesting also.
I think it would be good to maybe wrap this up, not go on for too long, because this has been a really wonderful conversation, but we're going to have several more sessions. It is to be continued, as it were. Maybe I could just finish off perhaps with by putting up again the links for everyone to see of the work of the Instagram accounts for Barbara. Really amazing work. I mean, I don't know, you need to go and follow Barbara. I saw that stuff and I was absolutely blown away. Joshua is kind of prodigiously producing things. I think it's slightly addictive mid-journey. I think that I get the suspicion that Joshua's completely addicted to it. And Sarah, what can I say, Sarah? I don't know. I've never seen you. This presentation, one thing you learn when you go through it as an academic is you spot talent when it's emerging. I remember being teaching at the AA when Akin Mengers and Neri Oxman were both actually students there, and you can recognize talent. And I could see, Sarah, you have got an amazing future. That presentation today was really amazing. So thank you so much for that. Really wonderful. I just want to mention that the team behind, I mean, that Sarah was part of the team behind, but so was Daniela, so was Angelica, so was Gustavo and Virginia and Bavlin, all our team. And it goes on and on and on. We have a whole team there. And I think what is so refreshing about this platform is the way that we've all come together to share our passions, to help others and to really, with this infectious enthusiasm. And I think today was one of those incredible moments when we've seen this passion for design, passion for fashion design, passion for architecture, passion for design as a whole, and passion for AI itself. So it was really inspirational. Just a kind of final comment, please try and follow Digital Futures YouTube channel and sign up there so you can get all the things that have been posted. We will post this afterwards there. Also, the Digital Futures website and on, of course, on Instagram, Digital Futures as well. And I'm also going to be posting on my Instagram account. So please follow us and see what happens. Next week, we have another incredible session. As we go through, it's going to be getting even more complicated and things are complex and advanced and so on. But this was an incredible starting point, a really useful introduction for anyone who knew nothing at all about it. And it was so, so useful as a session. I'm sure it's going to go many, many views. So can I just thank all our contributors today, to Barbara, to Joshua and Sarah, wonderful one for session, and thank all those behind this. And we'll see you all again next week, where we have another tutorial, the second of our five tutorials. So grazie, Barbara. I will just want to say that Barbara comes from Bologna, and she mentioned cooking, and Bologna is the Italian capital of cooking, but also it seems fashion today. So thank you, Barbara, and thank you, Sarah, and thank you, Joshua. Wonderful, wonderful session. Grazie.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Digital Futures.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you. Thank you, Sasha. Great to have you here.
Thank you, everyone. Amazing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.